Julia.
I'm Romeo.
I hope you had a good lunch and a good break. We are very sorry that we are a bit delayed, so by 15 minutes, but the website is already up to date. So our next speaker, Romeo.
Hi, Julia.
Hi. Works as a chief data scientist in the IBM Watson IoT Worldwide Web team. In his talk, he will introduce deep learning for J on top of Apache Spark with an example to create an anomaly detector for IoT sensor data with an LSTM autoencoder neural network. Please.
Okay, good. I'm glad that you didn't tell them all I've sent you in my speaker bio, because that's a lot. And then you think, oh my God, why did I send so much text to them? And you are standing here and she's talking. So I'm Romeo, I'm between two Juliets today. And where is Michaelis? Where is Michaelis? Not there. Because Michaelis, her husband, is working for IBM Research Zurich, and he offered me a job long time ago. Anyway, I was a bit proud and also shocked that he is in the audience, but he is not, fortunately, so I can tell you anything. So the talk is about deep learning. Who of you has used deep learning already in the past? In production? One? Okay, we have to talk. And who of you has used Apache Spark in production? Okay, at least some. Okay, so I'm Apache Spark guy, and I just tell you how to do deep learning on Apache Spark. Oh, who of you has used TensorFlow in production already? Or as a hobby project, maybe? At least some. Who of you doesn't know how an artificial neural network works? Who of you knows how an artificial neural network works? Okay, so that here's a disclaimer. If you kill yourself or your family or your company by doing anything I've told you, I'm not responsible. So I do a fast introduction into deep learning because a lot of you already know that. Then the same for Apache Spark, but more than half don't know it, so it's worth. Then I just show you two frameworks which you can use on top of Apache Spark, and then I show you a demo, okay? So machine learning, you can divide that into three main categories. And one is unsupervised learning and one is supervised learning. So unsupervised learning just transforms and visualizes your data in a way that you and your brain can make some sort of sense of your data. Whereas supervised learning is where you have data which is labeled. So the actual outcome you want to predict is already present in your historic data, and from that you can train a model. And within supervised learning you have two categories, it's regression and classification. Regression means you predict a continuous value, and classification is predicting a category. And if you have only two, it's binary regression, binary classification, and if you have more than two, it's multi-class classification. And that bottom thing is all that reinforcement learning. Maybe you've heard about the thing that Google won the Go against the Go champion. So that was reinforcement learning. But I'm mostly talking about unsupervised and supervised learning. So neural networks, a little 2 minutes crash course. So this is a data set from a hypothetical production machine. We are measuring three sensors. One is temperature and one is vibration. So three values, two sensors. And the outcome is the label. So that's supervised machine learning now, because that's historic data and this machine is creating parts and they are either broken or healthy. And if they are healthy, it's one. If they are broken, it's zero. So can any one of you come up with a simple rule, given the data set and given three sensor values, whether the part is broken or healthy at the end? Yeah. What is too much? You have been in my session yesterday. That's not fair. Okay. So except those who have been attending my session yesterday, what is a good value for vibration? Why is that not easy? Because you won't have only three parts, you will have 3,000 parts, and then maybe the temperature is 50, and the vibration is 20. So do you think it's broken or healthy? Yeah, that's where the domain knowledge comes in, of course. But yeah, maybe you're right. Depends on the physical system, of course, but for vibration, yeah? Don't cry. Okay, let's use 100, okay? You can also use 1,000, but you're correct. You need definitely more data, far more data. But that's an example of a white box model because you have some insights about the physical system and you implement something which you see what's inside the model. When your vibration is above 100, then you predict 0, otherwise 1. And it would be cool if you could learn such a model automatically. Have you seen this one before? Again, those who have attended my workshop yesterday are not allowed to speak. So what is this? Yeah, it's a linear combination. And it has also a name in the machine learning space. Have you heard about that? Maybe it's the Hello World algorithm. Nobody? It's called linear regression. Regression because I predict a continuous value out of my data plus parameters. So my data is definitely clear. It's max temp, min temp, and max vibration. And then I have A, B, C, D as parameters. If I now want to re-implement that model from before, this one, by choosing A, B, C, and D, can somebody tell me B and C? B and C parameters?
Zero.
Good. Okay. And then you could, for example, choose A minus 1 and D minus 1 over 3412. That would work. But this equation has an infinite number of solutions. But the thing is, you can have an algorithm learn A, B, C, and D for you. Therefore, it's called machine learning because the machine learns A, B, C, D. And then you get a linear regression model. So regression means I can predict a continuous value, but I want to predict a category. And you do a little addition in linear regression. So you take the output. So I'm showing a lot of Python code here at the Java conference, but Python is some sort of a subset of Java. No worries. The output of this linear regression model you just send to a function called sigmoid, which is 1 over 1 plus e to the power of minus x. And that does the following. That takes a value range from minus infinity to plus infinity and squashes it to a range between 0 and 1. And then you just define a threshold in the middle, and then you get a binary classifier out of a linear regression model. So those are the two Hello World machine learning models for predicting a continuous and for predicting a categorical value. And I'm telling that because of one reason, the neural networks are nothing else than stacked logistic regression models. So this is basically the same what we have seen before. So this is now one artificial neuron, and you have the inputs x1 to xn, and as in linear regression, you multiply that value by parameters, w1 to wn. Those individual values you sum up. That means until the sum symbol, you get something like linear regression. And then you take the output of that and apply it to a so-called activation function, which can be sigmoid. There are some others. And then that whole thing is something like a logistic regression. You stack them up, and this is inspired by biological neurons, but only inspired. So you have the neuron, the dendrites are the inputs, the axon is the connection to the downstream neurons, and on the axon terminals, you connect to downstream neurons via synapses. So here, the connection in artificial neurons is multiplication, And in biological neurons, the synapse is something much more complicated. So that's a biochemical coupling. And you need a lot of compute power to even simulate one. So there's a difference in biological and artificial neurons. But still, the concept applies some sort of. Because what you do is you have a look at the data. And the neural network automatically learns how to transform the data. So going from input to the output, there's one hidden layer here in this example. And the data is not flowing directly from input to output. It has to go through the hidden layer. And while it goes through the hidden layer, it gets transformed. And this transformation is learned by the neural network. So it will learn an ideal or a very good transformation. Okay, and that's the key thing. And the reason why it's called deep learning is that you have a lot of those layers and you learn a lot of intermediate transformations during training. Then Spark, another crash course in Spark. So the idea is if you do data processing on one single node, you might end up in problems because your main memory is not big enough, you have not enough CPU cores. So the first thing is, you divide your execution into multiple processes and then you fan out to multiple cluster members. And Apache Spark is just the glue around this. And then you need some data storage. So what the current trend is that you have a detached data storage, some object store, for example, and a fast internet connection. So for example, an InfiniBand switching fabric. And if that throughput is not enough, what you need to do is you directly attach storage to your cluster members and use a virtual file system. For example, is HDFS, Hadoop Distributed File System, where you partition your file, or where HDFS partitions your file and puts only a partition to each cluster member. And if you now read this file, you will read it with 5 times the speed of one hard drive. And if you have 1,000 hard drives, you have 1,000 times the speed. So if you have I/O issues, you need to have such a topology. If you are CPU bound, this is sufficient. Okay, so the central data structure in Apache Spark is RDD, Resilient Distributed Dataset. Who of you is Java programmer? Or was Java? Okay. So this is, imagine a Java collection which spans out on a complete cluster. So normally if you put more data into a Java collection than you have available on the heap, you get an out-of-memory error. In this case, you don't get it. So if you put more data into our RDD than you have in the aggregated main memory of all cluster members, it just spills the disk. Only if your disk is full, then you get errors. You can use multiple programming languages on Spark. So I have never done it in Java, but I've tried it in R, it sucks. But R itself is not my favorite language anyway. Scala is quite nice, but now I'm just using Python from day to day. I like it really much. Okay? It's very nice, but it doesn't matter because I'll show you later why. So one thing, how does Spark parallelize things? The idea is it uses functional programming. So you should know that as well, since version 8 of JDK, you have this lambda functions. So the idea is now a function is at the same level, a first-class citizen, like a variable or a constant, without using reflection, of course. It's just there. And then what you do is you want here, for example, increment each element in this array by 1. But in order to do so, normally you would iterate over that, but you can also send this function to this array, call apply. I don't know how it is called in Java. It's either, excuse me? Lambda. Okay. So are you sure? I think lambda is the construct to define a function, no? Isn't it? Map. Okay. It's either called map or apply. I think in Scala, in Python, it's called map as well. In Haskell, it's called apply. Anyway. The idea is that you apply the function to each element, and then you get the same result as you would increment over it. And this is useful for parallelization, because now you can partition your data into chunks and send this function to all these partitions, and those are now running in parallel, three times in parallel. Okay. So the RDD API, the functional API, is a bit complicated, and therefore now Spark understands SQL. So you wrap the RDD, or Spark wraps the RDD into a so-called data frame. And on top of the data frame, you have a relational API and also a SQL API. So you can run SQL statements against the RDD. And for the Scala and Java programmers, there's even a data set. So that's the typed version of data frame, which is even slightly faster. And the idea behind that is that you have now a optimizer like you find in relational databases, a cost-based optimizer, which generates execution plans out of your relational query. It doesn't matter if you use the relational API or SQL, it will resemble in the same thing. And that gets optimized. So first of all, a logical execution plan is generated, and out of that, multiple physical ones. And among the physical ones, the best one is chosen based on statistics. And another project which makes things faster is Project Tungsten, because I think everybody here loves the JVM, even I. But it's not the best thing to use the garbage collector for data processing, because the garbage collector tries to estimate object life cycle, but sometimes doesn't do the job so well, especially if you just have data flowing through the virtual machine. So the garbage collector has no idea how long it should keep the memory on the heap. So, and the other thing is there's a lot of overhead. So storing 4 bytes on the JVM heap needs 48 bytes. And therefore, Project Tungsten uses the unsafe memory management function of Java and manages memory itself. It makes it faster. And the coolest thing is it can generate bytecode. So imagine a normal relational database. So your SQL query is transformed into an execution plan, and each node in that plan is a process or a thread, and then data gets shipped between those threads normally. So what Spark does, it just takes the complete execution plan and generates bytecode out of it, without loops, without branches, and that makes it really fast. So that's called whole stage code generation, and is there since Spark version 2.0. So now I'm introducing two deep learning frameworks for Apache Spark I really like. One is called Deep Learning for J, and it has two important components. One is the Deep Learning for J library itself, and the second one is ND for J. This is a linear algebra library for the JVM, which is fast. And you don't change your implementation or your code if you change the underlying implementation. The underlying implementation can run on the normal instruction set on a CPU. It can run on this SIMD, the single instruction multiple data, vector data instruction set on a CPU, and it can run on a GPU. And if you want to activate a GPU, to just change one Java system property, and then it generates C++ CUDA code for you. And here is an example how you define a neural network and run a neural network in Deep Learning for J. So the conf object is the topology of your neural network, how many layers, how many neurons, which parameters you have. And if you say new multilayer network, you get a local configuration, a local neural network. If you say Spark DL for J multilayer network, then you get a Spark implementation. And there are two additional parameters, as you can see here. One is SC. So the Spark guys know that. That stands for Spark context. That's also a JVM object, which is some sort of the connection to your cluster. Conf, you already know, that's the topology of your neural network. And TM is another object which runs on the local machine, which is a parameter averaging training master instance, and that's responsible for the distributed training of the neural network. So there's some communication going on during training, and that's taking care of that. So let's skip the XOR example for sake of time. Then the second cool library I'm using is Apache SystemML. It's an IBM research project, or was. since many years, IBM Research Edmonton, and it's older than Apache Spark. It's used in IBM Watson as well. So the reason why they invented SystemML is that they wanted to break this cycle. So they have seen this cycle a lot before, 10 years, 15 years before. So you have R or Python or MATLAB. You implement your data science process, and then you have a systems programmer to scale it in C++ or Scala. And whenever there's a change, this loop continues, because the data scientist doesn't speak Scala or C++. And if he claims to do so, it's not a good idea to have them implement something in C++ or Scala, and the other way around. The system programmer normally has not so much of a clue. And I've seen that as well in projects. So the idea was, I really have to get this a bit faster. So the idea is, let's implement a domain-specific language for linear algebra. Any idea what this is, this syntax? You speak only Java. Any guesses? Excuse me? I don't know whether the C++ compiler eats a percent star percent. MATLAB is a good thing because, a good guess, because I told you it's a linear algebra DSL. So it's R. And you can make it out because of the percent star percent. So that's the syntax in R for a matrix vector matrix or matrix multiplication. In MATLAB, it would be a normal star. In R, scalar multiplication is a star. And in MATLAB, it's a dot. So it's a bit confusing. Anyway, this is R syntax. And now let's imagine, what do I have to do to create a parallel Apache Spark program out of this? Excuse me? That you can do anyway, but I'm vegetarian, so nada. Yes, but that's only the exposing the Spark API in R. So that doesn't, that's not useful, because then you anyway can learn this API in Python or Scala. So any other guesses? Excuse me? Yeah. Could you make this out because of the code or because I told you? You can, wow, okay. We are hiring. No, okay. Excuse me? It's a what? Yeah, that's this one. This one has 800 lines of Scala code. This one has 25 lines of R code. The result is the same. The performance is... Yeah, so the ALS is also a distributed version. But I tell you why this is better. So this is now R code. In order to turn that into a parallel Spark program, you do nothing else than just invoke SystemML and giving SystemML that code to eat. Because SystemML has a subset of the R syntax as domain-specific language. So that's ALS, okay. And that's the Spark implementation in Scala. And you see here it's way faster. So in R, you even don't think about doing anything useful. In the 12 GB set, you see Spark is slower. And in the, but we didn't do the test with Spark ML so far. So Spark ML is the new machine learning library in Spark. It's a bit old, but even with 120 GB, this implementation here is crashing. And in SystemML, it at least finishes. And the reason why this is so cool is because there's, as in relational databases for SQL, this is an optimizer on top of linear algebra code on two levels, high level and low level. High level operations are optimized by rewriting your ugly linear algebra code into something better. Here's an example. If you would execute that as it is, a large, dense, intermediate matrix, S would be materialized, which needs a lot of memory. So SystemML is that smart that it detects those patterns and rewrites your code into better one. That's the high-level optimization it does. And the low-level optimization, for each and every operation, the intermediate sizes and also the initial sizes of matrices are estimated and calculated, and then SystemML decides whether to run this on a CPU, on a GPU, on an Apache Spark. And also there on each one CPU per node or more. So that's something SystemML does out of the box for you. And then people just thought, why don't we implement a neural network or deep learning library in the SystemML DSL and have deep learning enabled on Apache Spark with the optimizer? And that's what we have now. So we have now a deep learning framework in SystemML, which is completely implemented in this domain-specific language. And here are some demos. By the way, I'm working for IBM Watson IoT, so I'm working with time series data, which I grab normally using MQTT from devices. And then you see that's our platform in the cloud. And the last circle here is your application and analytics. And then I thought, okay, so what can we do? We need to do two important things with the data. One is anomaly detection. One is time series forecasting. And another one, which I haven't covered so far with my learnings, is denoising. But you can do all this using deep neural networks very nicely. So two publications inspired me. This one here, that's a publication which states that they can outperform any anomaly detection algorithm which exists using a deep neural network. And the second one, they are stating the same for state-of-the-art in time series forecasting. And that's pretty interesting because kernelized regression is one state-of-the-art method. RMSE stands for root mean squared of errors. So that's how good or bad you are doing. The lower, the better. And the second row, it's called frequency neural network. So that means you have your time series data. So it's data in the time domain. You apply an algorithm on top of that, which is called DFT, discrete Fourier transformation, or FFT, fast Fourier transformation is one implementation of that, which transforms your time domain data into the frequency domain data. So you get the frequency spectrum of your data. And you fed in this spectrum values into a neural network. And if you do that, you are better than kernelized regression. It's 6.7%. The next step is you remove the DFT and you just add additional feedforward neural network layers and you train and you go down to 5.9%. That means you are learning a better data transformation than DFT does. And finally, the last line is, there is a special type of neurons which are called LSTM, long short-term memory networks. They have memory in the neurons. And they are very nice for time series and sequence data because they can remember what happened in the past. And they have added three layers with LSTMs and they went down to 2.8. Okay, so that's the concept you have to know. And now the demo is basically relatively simple. It's an IoT Industry 4.0 example. So you have a bearing and you want to predict whether that bearing fails or if that generates anomal vibration data. So you attach an accelerometer sensor on top of the bearing that gives you a three-dimensional time series. And since I don't have a bearing with me, here's a little test data generator. And that's a good time to introduce Node-RED to you. So Node-RED is developed in my team. It's open source. It runs on top of Node.js in JavaScript. And here I have implemented a physical model, which is called the Lorentz attractor model. Lorentz was one of the pioneers of chaos theory. And he found out that with that simple model here, you can already create chaotic data. So I've just used that. And this model has here four parameters, H, A, B, and C, and three internal state variables, X, Y, and C, and those are updated in each time step based on historic values of X, Y, and C, and based on the four parameters. And now I can just switch the model into a broken and healthy state by changing those four parameters. That's all I'm doing. Okay, so if you plot the data from the model into a so-called phase plot, so the phase plot has, so the trajectory of the line is time, and then you have three additional dimensions, so you can visualize four dimensions in that plot. So that's the healthy version of the data, and that's the broken version of the data. To make it a bit more simple, you can also plot it on a time series or run chart. So you have here the three dimensions, and you see here and here that the system oscillates between two semi-stable states. And also for the broken case, there's a lot more energy. And the first thing I've tried is just use FFT, get the frequency spectrum out of the two signals, and train a neural network. So those are 3,000 frequency bands. So you have 3,000 input neurons. And then you do binary classification. But you can do better. So supervised learning has always the problem that you need a lot of labeled data. So unsupervised learning is the key for a lot of unlabeled data. And this is, among LSTMs, the coolest thing I have found so far in deep learning. That's an autoencoder. Anyone of you has heard about autoencoders? Anyone used it already? Okay. So have you heard about PCA, principal component analysis? Okay, so I will just introduce all of that now for you. Normally, if you train a neural network, and if you have labeled data, then you show the data set on the left-hand side and the label on the right-hand side, and the neural network basically just learns the function or the relationship between those two. Since you don't have a label, you apply the input and on the same time the input at the output. So the neural network now will learn how to reconstruct your input at the side of the output. But we are a bit mean to the neural network because we are having only two or a limited number of neurons in the middle. So the neuron still tries to reconstruct the data on the right-hand side, but now everything goes through this neural bottleneck. Therefore, the neural network doesn't learn any noise or irrelevant data. So that's the first thing. Then you add LSTM layers in front, and then you train. So you train and train and train with your data set. You don't know whether it's normal or anormal. But a neural network now learns how normal data looks like. And it tells you at every point in time, how likely is it that I have seen such a pattern before? It doesn't tell you what the pattern is. So that's the black magic thing in neural networks. But it tells you, I have never seen that pattern before. Please have a look. That's what I'm going to demonstrate now. Here. So first I switch back to healthy. And then I'm creating this neural network. So this is the complete code using the neural network library of SystemML. And then I'm connecting to a MQTT broker for getting the messages. Oh, I have changed the network connection before. I shouldn't have done that. Okay, we have only 5 minutes left, so I will take questions in parallel. Any questions? Yeah.